I didn't enjoy being who I was. I just done it for so long, you know, that's the only thing I knew. You know, I had to be this, I believed I had to be this tough guy all the time, you know, and that's not who I am. And that's not who I want to be. The only one I can't check is that one. You know, and it's taken some time to realize that I don't have to be. You know, that it's my choice. Met my wife when I was 19. And, you know, we would just live wherever we could live. But of course, you know, the majority of it, I mean, there was never a day that I didn't drink and there was never a day that I didn't smoke weed. She was what I lived for, her and the kids. That was my sense of purpose. That was my sense of worth. Everything that I was wrapped around having them in my life. Done various aspects of construction my entire life. Wherever I could go to make the most money is what I did. And so we ended up moving over back over to my parents' property. And then that's when the fire hit. Anything that resembles any of my past was on that property. So we lost everything. Things started getting real bad real quick. A lot of arguing, a lot of fighting. I drove down to CPS. You know, I did not think they were gonna take the kids from us.
And speaking about Mike's case, reunification after parental rights are terminated is something we weren't doing 10 years ago. We started seeing more and more kids coming back into the system, or family members continuing to seek out placement of their children after parental rights were terminated, and started reconsidering how we were working with those families. When we met with Mr. Hoffman, it was at KC Family Programs. I believe that meeting went something like 3.5 hours the first time. And I was really impressed with him that day.
We receive referrals from Child Protective Services, and the program director, Holly, thought that this was a situation that we could help with to help get Maeghan home to her father.
So here at KC, we were trying to take a more deliberate approach to using data to improve outcomes for youth and families. And we had already started incorporating some of that into our broad evaluation work as we look at cases across all offices. So we started favoring methods that would help us see differences in outcomes. What we didn't have was a bridge to then really engage our individual field offices in how those patterns were playing out in their specific office. And so that's what facilitated collaborative inquiry does, is it gives the field office an opportunity to dive into their data as well as explore specific issues that are affecting their jurisdiction so that they can ultimately improve outcomes for their youth and families. We began with data, in particular data that can show the differences in outcomes that youth are having. And from there, we have the field offices unpack what that data is telling them by engaging them in a story process where they can share stories about their cases.
Came up with her birth family.
One of the main trends that we saw was that there was no shared vision of permanency within the team members. Understanding what that permanency looks like, the entire team needs to be on the same page about that.
Through the FCI process, the Austin field office was able to discover that cases where the multidisciplinary team struggled to share a vision of safe permanence for the youth, that those cases were 40% less likely to achieve permanency than the other cases they were serving. Maeghan's case fit this profile.
Especially when you could compare the different pieces, the age.
So they've developed a couple of different tools that they use to, one, start a conversation about the importance of having a shared vision, but then also giving individual team members the opportunity to kind of rate where they are. And at the end of the day, it can allow a team member to say, I don't fully agree with this. We kind of saw this in Maeghan's case, but I'm going to go along with the general consensus of the team. You know, in child welfare in general, a lot of times when data is used, it's you know, many times around compliance. So the data showing you where you're doing your job right or wrong, it sort of can sometimes feel punitive. And so it also, data would come at the end of the conversation, right? So here's the data, here's your problem, go fix it kind of thing. We tried to reverse that, where we used data as a conversation starter. We want to use the data to understand where we are today with the population and ultimately see if we can improve those outcomes. But our fundamental belief is that what makes change in the life of these youth and families is that social worker. It's the individuals and the other individuals that are involved in that case. At the end of the day, it's people's lives that are changing. You know, we may use a best practice or we may even develop a best practice along the way, but our primary aim is to develop a culture of best practitioners.
Maricela and her colleagues in the Austin office have become very adept at helping the multidisciplinary team members see families for who they are today rather than who they were when they came to the attention of CPS.
Mr. Hoffman was eventually given permanent managing conservatorship of Maeghan. And so now she is living with her father, and there is not CPS involvement for Maeghan.
Maricela played a very pivotal role and getting them to understand that I'm not who I was, and you know, just to look at all the steps that I've taken, you know, to better my own life, and how important it is for, you know, families to be made whole again. She definitely talked to me a lot about, you know, the differences between how I felt and how they felt. You know, she helped me to understand the department a lot more. Life now is great. Our daily interactions, you know, it's about just spending that time with her, you know. It's about talking about things that we wouldn't normally talk about. You know, hey, how are you feeling today? So it's really getting her to understand and believe that she's beautiful just the way she is. That she doesn't have to be anything other than that. You know, and just support her and what she wants to do with her life and who she, you know, who she is. And I think that's really the greatest gift that I could give her and really the only thing that I could do for her. The reality of it is I have a choice. You know, I can't change what I did, but I can choose to do it differently from now forward.